everybody. Welcome back. It's another fun week here at Sunday with Steve. I have my list all ready to go, so let's jump right in and see what we got to work with this week, because I know it's going to be a little tricky, but I think we might be able to pull some stuff together. Alrighty, so here's what you got for today. Okay, as you can see, February 15th, we have either National Gumdrop Day or National Chewing Gum Day. I can't make anything with either of those. So I'm just getting rid of it. We're just getting rid of that. I'll double up somewhere else. Last year we did a gumdrop martini just to come up with something. I found this recipe for that. And that was the only thing I could find. And I'm not making homemade gumdrops because I'm just not. But anyway, so here's the rest of the stuff that we have. Okay, the 17th and 18th I can definitely put together. 17th is Cabbage Day, and the 18th is National Crab Stuffed Flounder Day. So I'm thinking, I saw recently a recipe for a seafood stuffed cabbage. You know, like you make your traditional stuffed cabbage with the meat and the rice. This is a seafood one with shrimp and crab. And it sounded really good and really interesting. So I think I'm going to try that. So that'll pair those two together. So let's get rid of those. Okay, now because I got rid of the 15th, that gumdrop chewing gum thing, on the 13th, it's actually National Tortellini Day and National Italian Food Day. So what if we put those two together and we make an Italian-inspired tortellini dish, but something easy, something like casserole-ish. So we just kind of mix it all together and then bake it. You know, like a big ziti kind of thing, but with tortellini and some other stuff. We'll find some other stuff, but give it like an Italian twist. So that'll make up for that day we cut out, all right? So we'll put those two things from one day together. Okay, so for our dessert, our last couple things that we got for dessert, we have a peanut butter and jelly day, and we have an almond day, and then, of course, Valentine's Day. So what if we do a Valentine's Day-inspired dessert? Combining those two things, I've always wanted to do a Linzer tart, which is that double-layered cookie with the jelly in the middle, and it's kind of got the cutout window in the top of the cookie, and then you dust it with powdered sugar. I've kind of wanted to do that, so what if we do, instead of a peanut butter and jelly, we do an almond butter and jelly Linzer cookie, Valentine-themed. Sounds good to me. That sounds good. All right, I can do that. I can definitely pull that one off too. All right, that's our menu for today. So let's just get started. As usual, we'll start with our dessert first, just to get that done and get that out of the way. All righty, so we'll be right back. Okay, so let's get started today. We're gonna do our dessert first, as usual, because that's something you just like to get out of the way, and then you can focus on your other stuff later. Plus, the other thing is, this is one of those doughs for this cookie that I'm seeing that you have to refrigerate in between. You make the dough and then you refrigerate it first before you roll it. Yes, this is one that we have to roll out today. But you gotta refrigerate it for like an hour because we're gonna be cutting it into shapes. So that's gonna, you need to have it to be really firm to cut it. Otherwise, when you go to do, you've seen us do this a million times, and you go to cut it, this is why I don't do cookie cutter cookies, because when you cut it, if the dough is too soft, it's, you can't get it to the baking sheet. It's a big pain. but it's Valentine's Day, and I thought, okay, we have to do something for that theme. So that's what we're gonna do today. And we're, you know, always put our own twist on it. So in my mixing bowl here, I'm going to add, let's start with our almond butter to incorporate our almond day. Obviously, you can use just plain peanut butter if you want. You don't have to use almond butter, but we wanted to incorporate the almond somehow into our week, okay? Plus, it'll give it a different, I'm curious to see, it'll give it a different kind of taste rather than the traditional peanut butter, okay? So, I have my half a cup of peanut butter. I have a half a cup of light brown sugar. Trying to remember all these things as I go along. You'd think I'd have a cheat sheet here, right? We have 6 tablespoons of softened room temperature butter. Okay. Basically all our wet ingredients. And 1/3 of a cup, right? Yeah, 1/3 of a cup of light corn syrup. Okay, Okay, so you just put all of those into your bowl here, and we're just going to mix this together until it's smooth, okay? And then we'll add our next couple of ingredients. Once you see that's all mixed together, one egg, add to that, to our almond butter mixture, okay? And then here I have 2 cups of flour, and I'm going to mix with the flour 1/8 teaspoon of salt, 1.5 teaspoons of baking powder, okay? And I'm just gonna whisk those together. Okay, and then once I see that I have this nice smooth consistency, I'm gonna slowly add my flour to this, okay? Okay, our dough is done. Now I switched over to a wooden spoon because it's a pretty stiff dough, and my rubber spatula didn't seem to want to scrape this bowl too well. So I split this into 2 balls, okay? And I'm gonna wrap them in plastic and put them in the fridge for about 45 minutes to an hour, just to let them firm up really nice. And then we'll be back to roll these out, cut them, and bake our almond butter cookies portion of this for our Linzer cookie. Alrighty, see you in a bit. Once your dough is all chilled, you've got your nice block of dough, lightly floured countertop here, okay, and you're just gonna roll this. Now, I'm using this rolling pin that has these guides on it, so it'll give me exactly 1/8 inch, so I won't have to worry that some end's too thin, too thick, okay, so I just wanna roll this out as best I can. If you see that your stuff is starting to stick, because there's a lot of butter in this, so if you see it's starting to stick, just flour your roller, okay? Okay. Now this is a dough that you're gonna re-roll and re-roll with the scraps, okay? You need 2 cookie cutters if you're doing Linzers like we are. Larger, smaller. I'm doing hearts because it's Valentine's Day, so see, it's gonna make our little window in there, okay? Now, the reason why you split this dough into 2 balls rather than just doing it all at once too, is this dough gets soft pretty quick, okay? That's what I'm finding out here. So you want to make sure that the other one stays firm, so that way when you go to roll them, they're not, because the longer they sit out and the softer this dough gets, the harder it's going to be to get them off your counter and onto a baking sheet, okay? So you just cut those out first. I'm going to do my 3 solid ones. I'm guessing I'm going to get about 3 cookies. For each of these, because they're pretty big. These are gonna be a pretty big size cookie. They're not little cookies, okay? But that's okay, it's Valentine's Day, so that way you don't have to make as many. And that way you say, here, happy Valentine's Day. And they go, oh, what a nice big cookie, and you only need one. Now, the other trick is, I get this really thin metal spatula, or if you have a bench scraper, a really thin bench scraper, just flour it a little bit. Because what you'll do is you'll use this to loosen, just like that, your cookie, and then you're able to lift it. Because if you just try to do that, it tears, okay? Anyway, magic of television. That's what we did. We already did the first ball. This was the second ball, actually, but I just wanted to show you what we do when we roll them out. And then that's what you're going to get, okay? 3 whole ones and 3 with the center cut out of them. Start preheating your oven, 350, and we're gonna cook these for about 9 minutes, okay? 8 to 9 minutes. Keep your eye on them because you don't wanna overcook these, okay? And then when we come back, we'll assemble our cookies. All righty, be back. I forgot to tell you one more little tip too. When you have your whole ones here, don't cut out your mini circle or your mini heart, your window, until you have them on your parchment lined tray. Because if you cut them on the counter and then, because this sticks to the counter a lot, that's why I say lightly dust with flour. If you try to lift them once you cut the circle, it's like impossible to get them off the counter without ruining the whole shape. It stays better in this heart shape if you lift them whole. Then when you got it on the counter, just center it on your cookie and press and cut out the center. Okay? And what you'll be able to do once you cut these out is go back with like a little butter knife and just go and pop them right out. See, the center comes right out. Now you have this little heart, so you can leave the little heart on there by itself and use those for something else, you know, if you want to just decorate them or something, or just eat them like that. Okay, and then you got a couple little hearts as well. Okay, into our oven. So there they are, all out of the oven and cooled on our cooling rack. Make sure as soon as, like we always say too with cookies, make sure as soon as you take them out of the oven, wait like a minute or two, and then just take them off of the cookie sheet and put them on your cooling rack so the bottoms don't keep cooking. See, you don't want it darker than that on the bottom of your cookies. Any cookies, not just these cookies. Okay, so you let them cool down completely, and what you do is take one of your whole cookies. I have here some grape jam, because jam I find tends to be a little stiffer than a jelly, okay? And I love, you know, peanut butter and jelly, so grape is my jelly of choice if I'm gonna mix peanut butter, almond butter, whatever, with some jelly, then grape is the way I wanna go. So you just cover the bottom, but not too much. You don't wanna put too thick because you don't want it to ooze out of the sides and everything else, if you can at all help it. Okay, so I'm just kind of going to the edge, but leaving a little bit of an edge. Then you take one of your window cookies, put it right on the top, and just lightly press it together like that. And then, because this is such a deep well here, what you can do is just go in and put a little more of the jam inside the window. Now this will set up a little bit better once it sits for a bit, okay? But there you go. See, now you got this nice jam well in there in the cookie. So we're gonna let these sit, and then what you do, you just dust them with a little powdered sugar over the whole top, and there's your Linzer style cookie, okay? With our own little twist on it, as always. And then, like I said, you got these little, maybe we'll eat one of these little hearts and just see what our cookie itself tastes like. Interesting. I mean, it's a little dry, but that's kind of what a Linzer cookie I always found was. But cool. All right. We got our dessert done for today, once we assemble them. Time to get on to our two casserole dishes for today. Be right back. Okay, so let's get started on our seafood stuffed cabbage, which is our combination of the cabbage day and the crab stuffed flounder day. So we got lots of crab and some shrimp and all kinds of fun stuff. I'm going to heat up in this pan here. I'm going to melt down about 2 tablespoons of butter because we're going to make our sauce first. In this pot back here, I have some water getting ready to boil. We're going to salt that water. And then what we're going to do is blanch our cabbage leaves. I got a nice Savoy cabbage, which is seems a little firmer than a regular cabbage, the leaves itself. So basically, this is the hardest part of the whole thing so far, is getting these leaves off, okay? Because you want to make sure you get these little cups. And what you're going to do is blanch these, which is you're going to drop them into the boiling salted water for about 30 seconds. Take them out, drop them into some cold water to shock them, to stop them from cooking. And then you're going to just drain them on some paper towel. Okay? So, but we're going to make our sauce first because that's got to go into. It's almost like a traditional stuffed cabbage, like your Italian stuffed cabbage, with just some fishy variations. Alrighty? So to our melted butter here, like I said, 2 tablespoons of melted butter. We're going to add 2 tablespoons of flour. Okay, we're going to make our roux to thicken our sauce. Okay, so you just want to whisk that together and just let it cook for about a minute or so, just till it cooks out some of that floury taste, and make sure you really mix this well. Okay, and then to that, we're going to add 1 whole shallot diced up nice. Okay, whoops, dropped my handle in my pot. Okay, just mix that in. You're also going to mix in an eighth of a teaspoon of thyme, or a couple sprigs, fresh sprigs, and an eighth of a teaspoon of cayenne pepper. Okay, and we're just going to mix this all together. Once you've got that all mixed together, you're going to half a cup of white wine or sherry. I'm using cooking sherry, okay, just because I like the sweeter flavor of the sherry, which I think will go really nicely with this cabbage, okay? So you're going to whisk in that wine. As you can see, it thickens up right away. And then 2 cups of seafood stock. I finally was able to find some seafood stock. You had to go to Whole Foods to get it, which is where I figured I would find it if I was going to find it anywhere. If you're lucky enough to find it, great. Try a Whole Foods. That's where I had to go to. Supermarkets don't really carry it that much. I don't know why. I don't know if it doesn't have much of a shelf life. I don't know. Anyway, so 2 cups of the sherry, and you're just going to mix this together and bring this to a simmer until it gets nice and thick. It's going to thicken up with the roux, okay? Once your sauce is thickened up, just move that over to the side to somewhere else. Let that cool down, okay? You're going to move your pot of water here forward, because now we're going to blanch our cabbage. Okay, so there's our boiling salted water. Take a couple of your cabbage leaves, okay, and just drop them in for about 30 seconds, okay? Do a couple at a time, it's fine. Just want to be careful with them. We don't want to break them because we're going to have to roll our stuffed cabbage with these, okay? So you just put a couple in just for about 30 seconds. Here's my bowl of water, cold water with some ice cubes in it, just to make sure it's really nice and cold. Okay, so we're just going to do that. Like I said, about 30 seconds or so, not too long, because you still want it to be firm. And we're going to bake this whole thing with the sauce and everything after we're, you know, put it into a casserole dish and bake this whole thing. It's like a double casserole today, because our other dish is a casserole too. Okay, so you just kind of take them out right into the cold water. Just to stop them from cooking, okay? And you're just gonna do that. And once you just blanch them in the hot water and then dip them in the cold water, what you're gonna do is just take them out and put them on some paper towel and just let them drain, okay? And that's what you do. So we're gonna do that with all our cabbage, and then we'll be back to put our seafood stuffing filling together and then get this whole thing going. All right, we got our cabbage all done. Now in this pan, about 2 tablespoons of olive oil. I'm gonna start heating up here. What I have here is half of a nice big white onion, or just one small white onion, chopped up, and 1 red bell pepper, the whole pepper, same thing, chopped up, okay? 3 cloves of garlic that I use on my grater so I get it nice and finely grated. What we're going to do is saute these 3 things in our olive oil just till they're nice and tender, okay? We're not looking to brown them or anything else. Just kind of get them so they're nice and soft and tender, okay? So let's add that to that. Okay, our onions and peppers and garlic are all nice and tender. Let's start putting our stuffing for our cabbage together, okay? I have about, I don't know, 3 slices of bread. You can use whatever bread, white bread, any leftover bread. Just cubed up, okay? To that, I'm going to add some shrimp, which I just diced up. I had some leftover shrimp. You don't have to add shrimp in this one. You can do just the crab meat if you want. But I'm adding some nice pieces of shrimp that I just diced up nice and small, okay? To that, I'm going to add 2 eggs that I beat up a little bit, okay? I have here, remember, 1/2 cup of milk, okay? And about 1/8 teaspoon of celery salt, okay? A couple dashes of Tabasco, as hot as you like it, or if you have another hot sauce that you like. Doesn't have to be Tabasco, could be Cholula, could be Sriracha, could be whatever you like. Okay, so to that, let me mix that together first. Just get that all coated. It's almost like making meatballs, the milk and the bread thing. I know a lot of people use that whole meatloaf or meatballs, and they use like the bread and they soak it in the milk and then they mix it in. It's an interesting idea for this recipe. So I'm just gonna add my onions, garlic and peppers right to this. Okay, just kind of stir that around. And then the last thing I'm going to add to this is I'm going to add my crab meat. Now I have two different kinds here. I have a pound of crab meat, 16 ounces. I have 8 ounces of the claw meat, which is a little more affordable. It's not as expensive, so I'm just going to kind of break that up a little bit just to make sure we mix it in good. Okay, and then I have your lump crab meat, which is the pricier one. Now you don't want to break this up too much because you want to have those nice chunks of lump crab meat in your stuffing. You know, you don't want it just all mashed up together. So I'm just breaking it up a little bit because it seems to form a container shape sitting in the container. Okay, and I'm just going to gently kind of fold this all together, trying not to break up the crab meat as much as I possibly can. Okay, but this looks like a pretty interesting stuffing. I mean, there's not a lot to it, but I'm thinking it's going to be very tasty with the onions and the peppers and that sauce. Baking it in that sauce, I think, is going to really just do something for this. Okay, so there you go. There's your stuffing. Now it's time to assemble this and get her into the oven, because we got another dish that we got to start on too. Oh, by the way, don't throw out your pasta, your water, your hot water, your hot salted water that we blanched our cabbage in, because we're going to cook our tortellini in this. Okay, so just leave that for now, because why start over with a whole new pot of water? It's not really going to throw off the flavor of your dish, even if it's a little cabbagey. Alrighty? Okay, so I have my casserole dish here that I put my sauce in that we made, our seafood sauce. Okay, what you're going to do is take one of your cabbage leaves, okay? The reason why you blanch them is because it makes them softer and easier to work with and roll. If you tried doing it with the hard cabbage, it would probably crack all over the place. Okay, if you got a real stalky piece of the stem in the middle there, you can just trim that away if you want to. You don't have to. It's not going to affect the way you roll it or anything. It's just, you know, if you want that nice thick piece of cabbage there, go ahead and leave it there. But what I'm doing is taking my ice cream scoop and doing a nice big scoop of our filling, and then you just roll it like you would a burrito. You just sides, tuck in the sides. Okay, put your filling, and then just roll it. And you're going to put it seam side down into your casserole dish with your sauce. Okay, let me do one more just to do you one more quick refresher. See, it has this thick piece of stalk right here, which, like I said, you can just take a little paring knife and just trim it away if you want to. You don't have to leave that there, okay? So a nice big scoop of our crab and shrimp mixture. Okay, you know, you want to be generous because you got a lot of filling here. Okay, and you just, as you can see, you put the back side up first, then tuck in your sides, and then just roll it the rest of the way. Okay, seam side down in your dish. Alrighty, I'm going to do all of these and we'll be back when this is ready to go in the oven so I can show you what it looks like. Okay, I had to switch to a bigger pan because I had too much filling and too many cabbage rolls left. Okay, so that's what it should look like, and the sauce should come up to about halfway of your rolls. Okay, what you're going to do now, take some aluminum foil and cover this. We're going to put this into a 325 oven, and we're going to bake this for about 25 minutes or so, 25 minutes to a half an hour. Okay, because we want to make sure this is nice and cooked and tender. We want to make sure our filling, because our shrimp is raw, The crab is fine because you can just eat it right out of the container. It's, you know, it's cooked or whatever they do, processed already. But the shrimp we want to make sure is cooked, plus there's some egg mixed into our stuffing, so we just want to make sure everything is nice and cooked. Cover that, 325 oven, 25 minutes. Let me clean up this mess, because while we got our oven on and our water boiling still hot, we're going to put together our other dish, our casserole dish, and then it's up to you to decide. Do you want this for your appetizer or that for your appetizer? I don't know. You decide, but they're both worthy. Or maybe we'll just make a buffet today. Screw the appetizer, entree, dessert. We'll just put out a little buffet. All right. So while our cabbage is baking, let's get started on our other casserole dish for today. In a pan here, I'm going to add about 3 tablespoons of olive oil. And just let that get hot. I have my water boiling for my tortellini. I'm using frozen cheese tortellini. You can get the fresh kind, you can make your own. We'll probably do that at some point now that we make pasta. Okay, so there's my boiling water, that my salted water that I used for our cabbage. You might as well use it. Why make a whole nother pot of salted water? So I'm just gonna cook these just until they start to float. I'm not looking to make these tender because they're gonna bake in the oven in our casserole dish anyway, so we don't wanna overcook our pasta. So just make sure that you get it just to very al dente, like as soon as they start to float and you know your tortellini is pretty much, take them out of it, drain them, leave them in the pot, and we'll get started on this over here. In this pan with the oil, I'm gonna put, I have about maybe 4 or 5 cloves of garlic sliced because I love garlic and I want this to have that nice kick of garlic. We're gonna be using a pesto sauce today too. So that's just gonna add to the garlic of this, which is fine with me. Okay? Okay, once your garlic is just cooked just for a minute or two, okay, we're not looking to blacken or brown our garlic. I'm gonna take a full bag of spinach, baby spinach. Okay, and we're just going to saute this spinach just till it wilts down and cooks down, okay? Again, doesn't have to be overly cooked, we just want it nice and wilted. Okay, it only takes a minute or two. See, our spinach is all wilted down. So I'm just going to take this with my garlic out of here. And in this same pan, we're going to take, I have about 5 hot Italian sausage here that I sliced, and we're just going to brown these up, okay? So just get them into your pan here, and just cook these till they're nice and crispy and brown, okay? And they're nice and firm still, which is exactly what we want. Like I said, we don't want to overcook them, because there's nothing worse than mushy pasta. Okay, so we'll just continue browning our sausage here. What I'm going to do now in this big bowl is I'm going to take my tortellini. Okay, and I'm going to take, I don't know, about 1/2 cup or so of pesto. You can go a little heavier on it, just so that way we're going to be adding all this other stuff to it. So you want it to basically be a nice amount of sauce, okay? The pesto is actually going to act as our sauce today. So we're just going to toss carefully, don't break up your tortellinis, okay? Toss your tortellini with the pesto. And then to this, we're going to add about 1 pint of grape tomatoes, cherry tomatoes, whatever. Just slice them in half, okay? We're going to add that to our tortellini. And just toss them to coat them with the pesto sauce as well. Okay, mix that around in there. We're going to add our spinach and garlic to that now. And toss that around. This is going to be really good. It's almost like a caprese salad tortellini, but casserole style and hot. Okay, because of course we're going to add lots of mozzarella cheese to this as well. So I'm just tossing this all together, being careful not to really break up the tomatoes or the tortellini, okay? Just give it a nice coating of all the pesto sauce and just leave that there for now. So our sausage is all nice and brown, okay? And you're just gonna add that now to your tortellini, okay? and just toss that all together. Now our final ingredient for this, just add about 3 cups I have here of mozzarella cheese, shredded mozzarella. Probably save a little bit for the top, but just mix it about 2 cups mixed into this mixture here, okay? Let's get our casserole dish here now. We're just going to put this right in there. I mean, this has everything you need in a meal. It's got your meat, it's got your veggies, it's got your dairy. You got everything you need, okay? Right in this one dish. So I'm just gonna kind of spread that out. Look at that. That just looks amazing. I wanna eat it now. But I still gotta put some more cheese on the top. Okay. Now our cabbage is probably done by now. So we'll take that out of the oven. See how fast this one was to put together? We'll take that one out of the oven, bump your oven up to 400 degrees. And we're gonna put this one in there now, uncovered, for about 20, 25 minutes, okay? Just keep your eye on it. We wanna just melt all this cheese, get it brown. Everything essentially is cooked in here. The pasta is gonna finish cooking. And we'll be ready with our two dishes. Already, I got a bigger mess to clean up now. Be right back. Okay, there's our two dishes out of the oven. Let's take a look at this one first. Since it came out first, we've been letting it rest. Oh yeah, look at that. Oh, it smells great. You get this great seafood smell from it. Can't wait to try that one. And then, how I just put the cover on there, so the cover is actually not even hot. I didn't bake it with the cover, I baked it open. But look at that. Oh, wow, does that look good, huh? Tasty table time. Gotta talk some movies too. Lots to do today, alrighty? Be back. Okay, first up is our seafood cabbage rolls. They smell amazing. I don't know if it's that seafood stock that we used for the broth. But I'm really dying to see this. Let me see if I can give you a close-up. Oh my God, it smells so good. Can you see inside the rolls? You got all that shrimp and crab in there with the peppers. Okay, let's see what we got for today with this one. I'm choosing to start with this first because I'm assuming this is gonna be the lighter of the two. And usually, if you're gonna do, I mean, like I said, we're just kind of doing a double casserole day kind of thing, but if you're going to do an appetizer and an entree, try to start with the lighter stuff and work your way heavier, because if you eat the heavy stuff first, you're probably not going to want the lighter stuff after. Mmm. Oh, wow. That is really good. Great flavor. I mean, I'm a fan of regular stuffed cabbage with the meat and the rice. But this one is just with the seafood. Not really what I expected, but really happily surprised. Look at that. I mean, you get, put my plate, get all this great crab meat and stuff in there. Get some of that broth. I probably just need a little bit more of the sauce for it as it falls off my fork. Oh yeah, I would definitely do this one again in a minute. Actually, I'd probably add even more seafood to this, really, just to knock it up a little further, put some the little bay scallops in here, maybe even some mussels or some clams. Oh yeah, I definitely would do this one again. I mean, even with the cabbage, it's so tender. Because it, you know, cooked in the sauce and everything else. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. Really perfect. Okay, let me finish this, and then we're going to move on to that tortellini, that sausage tortellini with the pesto. That thing just looks so good when it came out of the oven. It's all browned on the top with the cheese and everything. We'll be back. Okay, there's our tortellini. Look at this thing. When you let this thing just, like, sit and rest for a little bit when it comes out of the oven, obviously you know, I'm not a super scorching hot food eater, so I don't take stuff usually right away, but it almost becomes like lasagna-ish. Like it holds this shape that it baked in, even if you cut out a piece, you know? So anyway, just babbling. Just a little observation there, but I mean, look, it's got all this great cheese melted on the top. And you got all the spinach, the tomatoes. I want to get a little bit of everything in my bite here. There's a tortellini. There's some spinach, a tomato, and a piece of our sausage. Mm. Wow. Talk about super easy dinner casserole. I mean, you saw how we made this thing. Super, super easy. And this pesto flavor just gives it, you know, with the tomatoes and the spinach and all that extra garlic that we added, which we love too. So flavorful. Oh, such a great dish. And not really an unhealthy dish if you think about it. I mean, yeah, you got some pasta, you know, with the tortellini, but I think it's a lot of veggies and pesto and some sausage. It's not gonna kill you. So I guess when I said it's the heavier of the two today, but it's not necessarily a heavy dish either. So yeah, we did really good today with both our dishes. And now it's on to our favorite part, dessert and movies. So let me finish this and be back. Let's wrap this show up for today. Okay, so dinner was fantastic today. I really enjoyed both those dishes we made and our Valentine's. I changed into red for our Valentine's dessert, which are these wonderful Linzer tart style cookies. I'm going to try one now while we talk movies. Okay. Look at that. Look at that beautiful dessert. Okay. Perfect. That classic peanut butter and jelly flavor. Really nice. Not too sweet. Works perfectly. And I never did a Linzer before, so it's nice to do a Linzer and Valentine's theme. Okay, let's get to our movies. We watched A Place in the Sun. Really so well done of a movie. And when you see Elizabeth Taylor, a young Elizabeth Taylor, show up on screen for the first time in that movie, you're just like, oh my God, how stunning is this woman? Really amazing. And all the performances are fantastic. This is also the first movie that won a Golden Globe for drama. So that's kind of historic as well. Our other movie, really recommend that one. Our other movie that we watched, My Fair Lady, it's a musical. For those of you that don't like musicals, I know. Oh, see? Look. Ding! Somebody's saying, I don't like musicals. I just want to suggest watching this one just because the performances in this movie, Audrey Hepburn's accent, her Cockney accent that she does throughout this movie is just, I mean, she could teach a master class on this accent. I mean, it's just so well done. It's extremely fashionable. If you're into the fashion aspect of a movie, if you love, you know, seeing the costuming and everything, I mean, this is just unbelievable. And there's a bunch of songs that you'll hear and you'll say, oh, I know that song. I didn't know that was from My Fair Lady. One of them, the funniest being, I Could Have Danced All Night, which a lot of you may remember from The Birdcage, which to me made that scene now even funnier that it's from My Fair Lady. Anyway, just babbling here. Let's get to our two movies for this week. I highly recommend My Fair Lady 2. It's not my favorite musical of all time. That would either be West Side Story or Jekyll and Hyde, which I saw on Broadway, which I thought was amazing. That's like right up there now. Something current and something old. Anyway, but let's get to this week's movies to watch and see what we think about these. Alrighty? Okay, so for this week's movies, we have number 90, The Jazz Singer, 1927. This is not the Neil Diamond version. Although, I think if I remember right, this is probably a current version of that, a remake, you know, but like a updated version of it, because 1927 I believe it's a silent movie, but we'll see when we watch it. Okay, so that's The Jazz Singer. Okay, and then number 89, we have Patton, George C. Scott. I think maybe I've seen this one once before, but like I say every week, even if we've seen it, we're going to revisit it and watch it again, because a lot of times you pick up stuff from a movie after watching it a couple times that maybe you didn't pick up the first time through. But I'm anxious to see this one again. Okay, so that's it for today. Happy Valentine's week. Do something special with the one you love. Make cookies for them. Linzer cookies. And this dinner, super easy. Alrighty, see you next week, everybody.